We live in an invisible jungle of communication. Down there, 10 million people could be talking to each other at any one time. Their voices traveling at the speed of light are going over you, under you, and sometimes right through the middle of you. And all that because of the telephone. It is astonishing to think that if I really wanted to and had the right numbers, within moments, I could be talking by telephone to pretty well anyone on just about any part of the planet.
It's quite absurd.
Today, we take this communication on demand very much for granted. For most people, the thought of being without one's telephone is worse than the thought of being without one's trousers. But the story of how we got the phone and came to be so reliant on it is a story of skullduggery, death, electrocution, and enormous personal sacrifice. The high-tech dream of getting messages to fly through the air has not come easily. Pigeons have been carrying messages for hundreds of years. Off you go, Biggles. As late as the First World War, winged messengers were routinely used to carry sensitive notes across enemy lines.
Biggles! Biggles!
Brave military pigeons were even decorated.
I can't think why. They are fantastically unreliable.
And where would they pin the medals anyway?
You've dropped the message!
What was needed was a system where you didn't actually have to carry anything. Beacons, smoke signals, even drumming was tried. Anything to stop the skies becoming choked with all those unreliable birds. But in the 18th century, they finally cracked it.
This is it. Well, actually, this is a scaled-down model of it. The real thing would have been 10 times bigger. It's called the visual telegraph, and it's absolutely brilliant. You see, it wasn't just limited to saying yes, no, on, off, fire, stop firing. This, if you wanted to, could say the quick brown fox jumped over the lazy dog.
The visual telegraph formed an enormous network that covered much of southern England. Messages were flashed across the country from stations set 10 miles apart. The 6 shutters could be arranged to symbolise the letters of the alphabet. It worked, and it was fast. Messages could be sent from London to Portsmouth in just 3 minutes. That's 2,400 miles an hour, 3 times the speed of sound.
That is pretty impressive, but things were about to get much, much faster. You see, most early forms of communication used something you could see, something visible, like fire. But by the end of the 18th century, people began to realise that things would be better if they used something invisible. Electricity.
People had known about electricity for hundreds of years, but it wasn't until the 18th century that they began to realise its potential for communication. In 1746, a French abbot decided to carry out an experiment on his monks. He connected them to each other and then to a battery. The monks screamed simultaneously, telling the abbot 2 things. Electricity really, really hurts, and it travels instantaneously.
Electricity can go around corners, it can cover vast distances, and it's fast, very fast. It goes at very nearly the speed of light. Now, it was a British chap, writing anonymously, actually, in the Scots magazine, who first suggests that it could be used for sending messages. But it was an impoverished American artist who first worked out how that might be done.
The artist in question was Samuel Morse. For 3 months of 1832, the 41-year-old Morse was on a boat. He was serious about art, so obviously had no choice but to leave America and come to Europe. Trouble was, the price of culture was 6 weeks in a sailing ship, each way. Slow. Very slow.
Hands to sail, sailing stations! Prepare to set both to gallant.
Morse was a man with a tragic interest in speeding up communication. Just 4 years earlier, his wife had died unexpectedly while he was away. He'd missed her funeral because the news of her death had taken so long to reach him. If only there'd been something quicker, maybe electricity.
Hey, Morse, bracing square, round me like on hold.
Like most great inventions, Morse's breakthrough was staggeringly simple. Why not, he thought, use bursts of electricity to signify letters of the alphabet? The dots and dashes that make up Morse code were born. But not content with simply inventing Morse code, and let's face it, he did have 6 weeks to fill, Samuel went one step further and spent the rest of the voyage inventing a means to transmit it. He came up with the electronic telegraph.
Very, very simple piece of equipment. What you've got here is basically a clockwork mechanism. You wind it up here and you turn it on here. Here is your electromagnet, which is affected by the current being sent from somebody separately. This moves a bar along here, and at the end here, there's a wheel that sits in a pot of ink, which presses up and touches the slip, and then you can send simple messages, which reads SOS, and you can read it here, dot, 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 dash, 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 dot, dot, dot.
Samuel Morse's telegraph signalled the start of the race for the telephone. Electronic communication had begun. The pigeon had been replaced with a courier which travelled at very nearly the speed of light. The 19th century had changed forever.
To begin with, people just simply didn't understand how it worked. You've got a lovely case where a lady went into a telegraph office with a large bowl of sauerkraut to try and send to her son. And the cable operators explained to her this was an impossibility, and she said, well, it can't be because he was ordered to the front line by a telegram, so I'd like to send my sauerkraut to him by a telegram.
Eventually, people stopped trying to send pickled vegetables over the telegraph and began to use it to improve society. A murderer who, having done the foul deed in Slough, had escaped to what he thought was the safety of London by train. And before the telegraph, he would have got away with it, but the local police wired his description to their colleagues in London, who simply met the criminal's train and arrested him. There were international advantages too, but of course the French tried to sabotage things.
The first truly undersea cable was the one that ran from Dover to Calais, but that was a bit of a disaster because a French fisherman trawled it up and thought it was a really rare piece of seaweed and cut a section out to take back to his wife and show her.
The telegraph, despite the best efforts of French trawlermen, soon spread across the world. The first transatlantic cable was laid in 1857. Now it took seconds for a message to travel under the very ocean that it had taken Morse 6 weeks to cross. The telegraph really did change the world. It meant that newspapers could run next day reports from around the globe. It was the Victorian information superhighway. It was the 19th century cool thing. People even met and married on it. The Daily Telegraph was so called to reflect its radical, new, confident technological approach. The trouble is that the telegraph-Morse code combination does have its limitations. I mean, sending even the simplest message on a machine that can only go dot, 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 dash, dash, would try your patience a bit. I mean, you wouldn't use this to send the story of the invention of the telephone, because this is a tale of greed, theft, vast amounts of money, blind chance. There's even a sprinkling of whodunit. The mystery of who invented the telephone begins in America. By the 1870s, the US Railroad and the telegraph that ran alongside it had finally conquered the Wild West, revolutionizing communication. Lots of people made lots of money thanks to the telegraph. The trouble was that a copper wire could only carry one message at a time, and there were just too many wires. The telegraph was becoming a victim of its own success. Something needed to be done. Huge rewards were on offer to anyone who could find a way to make the telegraph more efficient. So the race was on. Hundreds of men of science applied their massive brains to the problem. But few came close. One of them, however, was Alexander Graham Bell. Alexander Graham Bell was born in Edinburgh. He was clumsy, impulsive, enthusiastic, fiercely ambitious, and he was an obsessive thinker. And what he was thinking was, surely you can send more than a simple dot and dash down a length of copper wire. And so it was. In 1871, at the age of 24, he up sticks and moved to Boston, Massachusetts. New England and a new life. It was here that Bell came to seek his fortune. And while he waited for his fortune to turn up, he filled in time teaching deaf people to communicate.
I'm going to show you how sound works.
He was convinced that the answer to the telegraph problem lay in sound, not speaking, not the telephone, just sound as a way of making Morse code more efficient. His idea meant turning sound vibrations into electrical signals. But he couldn't. The trouble is, Bell was in a race. Thousands of miles away, in Ohio, there was a humble Quaker farmhand called Elisha Gray, and he had worked out how you could transmit sound down a piece of copper wire. The improbably bearded Elisha Gray had seen the electric telegraph transform his rural backwater and had been fascinated by it ever since. By the age of 38, Elisha, who'd attended night school, had become an expert in electricity. So much so that the men who ran telegraph giant Western Union were backing him as their man in the making the telegraph more efficient race. Their faith in Gray was well placed. He was about to take the lead thanks to some batteries, a bathtub, and a 9-year-old boy. Elisha Gray's nephew had found his uncle's batteries in the bathroom and had discovered that he could use them to make a strange new sound by rubbing his hand along a zinc bathtub. As is the way with adults, Gray immediately wanted to have a go with the new toy himself. He realized that he was making an electrical circuit. Small amounts of electrical current were traveling from the batteries through Gray's body and back into the battery, but oddly, the electricity seemed to be causing some sort of very faint noise, which was amplified by the bath. Gray found that by altering the position of his hand, he could change the length and resistance of the electrical circuit, but crucially, as he moved his hand, the sounds changed too. Gray had discovered that electricity can carry sound. It was the first in a chain of events that would lead eventually to the invention of the telephone. But at the time, Gray had no idea of the significance of his buzzing bath. Meanwhile, back in Boston, the ambitious Scott was keen to move on with his ideas and acquired staff in the form of skilled craftsman Thomas Watson. Bell had abandoned the idea of multiple messages and was going hell for leather in pursuit of the talking telegraph, even though he still had no idea how to electrify speech.
If I could make a current of electricity vary as precisely as the air varies during the production of sound, I should be able to transmit speech telegraphically.
Mr. Bell, I feel the tuning fork will be no good. The vibrations are too weak.
But the vibrations are the key. It's the sound as we see it. I mean, subtle as they are, it's those that we must capture.
Then it must be a thinner metal.
Bell may have hit on the idea for a telephone, but over in Ohio, Elisha Gray was about to work out how to actually build one. Boop, boop, boop.
Do we have a disco? Shouting.
Again, Gray's nephew was on hand with a breakthrough. Gray was struck by the remarkable similarity between the vibrations of a string carrying the boy's voice and his own work with the telegraph. Back in his lab, Gray set about building a machine that could transmit different sounds. Gray, like Bell, had decided that sound was the key to a better telegraph, and he was intent on using different musical notes. Critically, he hadn't made the leap to speech. He was hell-bent on using music to send multiple Morse messages for Western Union. And so, in January 1874, Elisha Gray had the basis for what we now know as the telephone. Enthused by the idea and in search of cash, Elisha made the journey here, to Chicago. Full of trepidation, the unassuming inventor demonstrated his harmonic telegraph to his paymasters from the telegraph company. But even though they understood that Gray could transmit sound and they could hear the evidence, the men from Western Union didn't make the leap to speech either. And they weren't impressed. They wanted more than one message at a time in Morse code down one wire as discussed. Humming, music, talking, they'd be ridiculous. So needless to say, the check was never written. Now, you can forget the man who turned down the Beatles. That has to be one of the costliest mistakes in the whole of human history. At about the same time in Boston, the altogether luckier Bell wasn't being downtrodden by the kind of visionaries who'd hamstrung Gray. The immigrant Scott and his technician were hot on the heels of Elisha Gray and were also discovering all about sound going down wires. The tuning fork idea was about to bear fruit, albeit accidental fruit.
Mr. Watson, do I have the right connections here?
Yeah. Are they all tightened?
Yes. I'll proceed now. Please take note.
Mr. Bell, a moment. The reed is stuck.
The sound of Watson's fumblings were carried along the wires down the corridor.
What did you do?
The reed was sucked, so I took...
Do it again! Repeatedly!
Without realising it, Bell and Watson had made a sort of primitive microphone. Even so, it was nowhere near sensitive enough to pick up the human voice. The transmission of speech was still a long, long way from reality, and certainly nowhere near Boston. Back in the Midwest, Elisha Gray had finally hit on the idea of talking, but he too was short of a microphone. Alone and without funding, Gray continued his research and hit on an idea to capture speech vibrations in a liquid. It was a brilliant and crucial breakthrough. Gray's drawing showed a telephone system that would have worked. Gray had no idea of the value of his diagram, but being a professional inventor, he sent it along with a whole stack of other ideas to the US Patent Office. Gray had done what he did routinely, only this time his patent application would change his life forever. Back in Boston, Bell was still unable to get his telephone system to work. But knowing that the Gray posse were on their way to Washington loaded with ideas, Bell sent his idea to the US Patent Office too, just in case. Only it was less of a practical solution than a statement of intent. Kind of, wouldn't it be brilliant if we had a telephone? So, on Valentine's Day 1876, couriers for both men arrived at the patent office. It was Bell's man with Bell's telephone idea who arrived first,
and presented it to an examiner. Just 2 hours later, Gray's courier, carrying the crucial diagram, presented the bundle of patent applications to the same man. The race for the invention that would change the world came down to a photo finish. Now, yes, that could be a coincidence. Two men from different sides of the continent appearing in the same office, in front of the same examiner, on the same day, with the same idea. But what happened next doesn't look like a coincidence at all. You see, within a few days, this paragraph appeared on Bell's patent application, fleshing it out, giving more detail. And back in his laboratory, Bell drew this diagram. Should we compare it to the one that had been drawn by Gray a few weeks earlier? Same use of liquid, same transmitter, same head. I'm prepared to put the same day thing down to a coincidence, but this is altogether rather more fishy. So what happened? How did Gray's idea end up on Bell's patent application? Well, it's the old, old story. With so much money to be made from the patents, petty cash was in plentiful supply. The temptation to accept bribery was overwhelming. Both applications arrived in the hands of one man, Zenas Wilbur. And as Zenas admitted in later life, it was he who sold Elisha Gray's idea to Bell's lawyers. So instead of Gray, it was Bell who was granted the lucrative patent for the telephone. At the time, no one realized what had happened, but Bell leapt into the lead. Armed with his new ideas, the breakthroughs just kept on coming.
This is quite a bit different from what we're doing in the past.
Yes.
Just 2 weeks after filing his magic, self-altering patent, Alexander Graham Bell had got himself a brand new design. At its heart lay a freshly, invented liquid transmitter. In fact, the whole setup was remarkably similar to Gray's diagram. But no matter, Bell was poised to make history.
Mr. Watson!
Come here, I want you.
I heard it. I heard it.
You heard what?
I heard you call me.
So to be fair...
it worked.
However he came to do it, Alexander Graham Bell did make a phone call in March 1876. But back in Ohio, Elisha Gray knew nothing about it. When he first heard of Bell's success, the humble Quaker accepted defeat gracefully. But as he learned more about the design, the truth became horribly clear. Gray had invented the telephone, but Bell had taken it from right under his nose. He tried to sue, taking his claim all the way to the US Supreme Court, but he was not successful. He died in 1901, aged 66, unknown and unrecognized. Bell's story, on the other hand, is the embodiment of the American dream. The impoverished Scottish immigrant died fabulously wealthy in 1922, leaving a vast business empire known today as AT&T, one of the biggest communication players in the world. But that wasn't quite the end of the story. In recent years, the mystery of who invented the phone has taken another unexpected turn. The latest twist in the tale of the telephone takes us to Cuba, where it's claimed the telephone was really invented. What's more, it's also claimed that the inventing took place a staggering 20 years before Bell had even set foot in America.
Enter Havana-based Italian scientist Antonio Meucci. Now it's clear from his beard alone that here was a man born to telephony. But in the 1840s, Antonio's thing was analgesia. He was convinced that pain could be cured by wiring patients up to the mains. He tested his theory on his wife Esther, who, as luck would have it, suffered from arthritis. So one day, Meucci was going about his business of electrocution when Esther, as you can imagine, screamed out in agony. But her scream didn't just resonate down the corridor, it also travelled to Meucci through his copper wires. Meucci, who was rather taken with the unexpected side effect of his treatment, set about developing an instrument that could transmit speech along a wire from one place to another. In 1850, Meucci came here to New York. Now, by this time, his wife was seriously crippled with arthritis. So he wired up the whole of his house so he could hear her no matter where he was. And that, in my book, is a telephone. This is the house in question, where Meucci spent the next 20 years perfecting his apparatus. There was a mouthpiece and an earpiece, and the sound was apparently transmitted electronically along lengths of copper wire. So if Meucci's telephone really worked, how come he didn't walk away with a patent worth billions? Why did he die a pauper? Well, in 1871, Meucci was badly burned in an accident on the Staten Island ferry. And while he was recovering, Esther got her revenge for the electrocutions and sold her husband's invention for just $6. He could never afford to buy it back. More than 100 years later, on June the 12th, 2002, after some heavy pressure from the Italian-American lobby, the US Congress passed a resolution declaring Meucci, not Bell, as the inventor of the telephone. So, three men, three beards, three claims on the telephone inventor title. But for me, the winner is Bell. Whatever the US Congress resolves, and despite the rights or wrongs of his methods, it was Bell who actually got the ball rolling. When he died in 1922, the world had more than 14 million telephones. So it was Bell who changed the way the world communicates. He even changed the way the world speaks. Until the phone, we would say good morning, or good afternoon, or good evening, but the telephone demanded something snappier.
Hello, hello, hello.
Hello, Otto.
Hello, hello.
Once people had worked out how to use it, the telephone really took off, and the hello girls could connect you to a different world.
Mr. Parsnip speaking.
Chunks and toll and telegrams and all exchanges too. Just telephone and we will pass you through.
Ring ever corner Otway.
We play it now, hop or slow.
Ring anywhere, we're waiting on your phone.
Do you want a little warning to make you get up in the morning?
Is your house on fire?
Do you want yourself a wire?
Just lift up the receiver.
Charming ladies, but a dying breed. And this is what killed them. It's the Strowger switch.
The invention of the Strowger switch is another tale of deviousness, deception, and death. But the man responsible wasn't an inventor, he was an undertaker, and he lived in the Wild West. Olman B. Strowger had the good fortune to be a funeral director in Kansas City, where business was booming. In the 1880s, the forward-thinking undertaker was convinced that his investment in one of those new-fangled speaking things would help breathe even more death into his business. Having bought a telephone and had it connected to the local exchange, Strowger found that his business, far from growing, began to fade away. To his horror, Strowger discovered that a competitor's wife, who worked on the exchange, was diverting all the calls to her husband's funeral parlor. Strowger Strowger decided to use his knowledge of electricity to bury the competition, and he came up with this electromechanical switch, which could connect one telephone line to another without going through the operator. He called it his girlless, curseless, out-of-orderless, weightless telephone. Strowger's switch was the key component of the unmanned exchanges that would enable the telephone system to spread. For the first time ever, you could dial directly from one phone to another. All you had to do was telephone. No one had to put you through. It was such a radical idea that in the UK at least, direct dialing had to be taught in helpful films like this.
Now you hear the ringing tone, which synchronizes with the ringing in the house of the distant subscriber. Do not abandon a call without allowing a reasonable time for a distant subscriber to answer.
Thanks to the Strowger switch, the telephone was able to conquer cities, countries, and eventually whole continents. By the 1930s, the telegraph was dead. The telephone reigned supreme and, for the first time, was about to play a major role in the theatre of war. At the beginning of World War II, London was being bombed nightly by the Luftwaffe, so Allied command had to be secured deep below ground. Under Whitehall lay a nerve centre of communication that few people knew existed, and it was from here that the Second World War would be won or lost. And it was very nearly lost. Here in the cabinet room, the British government would meet, safe from German bombs. There'd be Anthony Eden, Clement Attlee, Lord Beaverbrook, the Joint Chiefs, and here in the wooden chair at the head of the table, the great man himself, Winston Churchill. Late into the night, in an atmosphere laced with cigar smoke, they'd talk about the North African campaign, the Battle of Britain, the North Atlantic convoys, assuming everything they said was a secret. But it wasn't. There was an enemy in the heart of government, a mole so dangerous that the thoughts and strategies of Churchill himself were being delivered into the hands of the Nazis. It's incredible, really, when you think about it. This secret little room, in a secret place, full of people sworn to secrecy, far below the streets of London. But there was just one weak link. That. Thanks to the telephone, precise details of the British war effort were being broadcast to the world, and no one in Whitehall realised what was going on. Churchill knew that reliable communication was vital to the outcome of the war. But it was one specific line of communication that was absolutely crucial to Churchill's plans. His regular transatlantic phone calls to President Roosevelt in America. The calls were all very hush-hush. Even the location of the Prime Ministerial telephone was a closely guarded secret. Had anyone seen Churchill preparing to call the President, they would have assumed something else entirely, because they would have seen him let himself into this unassuming room. It's a broom cupboard, disguised as a lavatory. On a telephone in this room, the first hotline to America, Winston Churchill would hold some of the most important calls in the whole of history. Unfortunately, he may as well have been standing outside with a megaphone, because the Germans had a listening station off the Dutch coast and they could hear every single word he said. The trouble was, in the 1940s, the only way to speak across the Atlantic was by radio, so anyone with a listening device could tune in and hear the latest news about supply convoys, troop movements, and vital new initiatives. When the Allied High Command eventually realised that Churchill was inadvertently telling Hitler everything, the Allies had to think big. The leak in Churchill's lavatory needed to be plugged, and quickly.
So what they came up with was this, an encryption device called the Green Hornet.
In nothing, great or small, large or...
The way the Green Hornet worked was deceptively simple. A recording of white noise made the phone call unintelligible. And then, on the other side of the Atlantic, an identical recording was subtracted, so the president could understand what Churchill was saying. The Green Hornet carried conversations about D-Day, Himmler's offer of surrender, and even Hiroshima. And with these phone calls secure, the outcome of the war became more of a certainty. The Green Hornet's encryption was so powerful that, unlike Enigma, it was uncrackable. Even today, the Green Hornet cannot be beaten. Churchill marvelled at the fact that he could pick up the phone and have a completely secure conversation with someone on the other side of the Atlantic. Once, he remarked, it astounds me. Nobody can tap the phone. It's completely impossible to do so. Progress, perhaps, is too fast. One wonders where we are heading.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Ignition.
We were heading, as it turned out, into space. As we all know, the space race brought with it all kinds of giant leaps for mankind, non-stick saucepans and Velcro, to name just two. But perhaps more importantly, it gave us something that the likes of Arthur C. Clarke had been banging on about for years. Global telephony using satellites. It sounded like piffle, but in 1962, British technicians built a dish in Cornwall which could receive telephone calls from America via space with no wires. They called it Arthur, and it was a Leviathan. In this case, size really did matter. The Cornish dish had to be big enough to track a tiny 3 foot by 10 foot satellite travelling at 35,000 miles an hour, 2,500 miles away. The satellite was called Telstar. On July the 10th, 1962, Telstar became the first telecommunications satellite to be launched into orbit, and Arthur was its UK receiving station. Just hours after the launch, and with Arthur locked on, these were the first words to travel from America to Britain via space.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, Andover. Hello there. How's it sound to you? Very good toward me. Who's this speaking?
With testing complete, it was over to the BBC for a more momentous and much more public second international phone call via satellite.
Hello, is that Alastair Cook in New York?
Yes, it is.
This is David Wilson. I'm speaking from the centre of London. Where are you in New York?
Over the decades, hundreds of communication satellites have been sent up into space, and millions upon millions of miles of cable are buried in the Earth below. With every part linking together, operating in sync, the vast, largely invisible web of communication has now become the biggest machine in the world. Instant global communication is in full swing. Think what is flowing through this dish today. Good news from Australia, bad news from Argentina, no news from New Zealand. People listening to Muzak as they wait to be put through to Mr. In Saigon. People talking to 0898 girls in California. Credit card transactions from the Caribbean, banking deals from Africa, the Indian internet, trillions and trillions and trillions of ones and noughts every single hour of every single day.
The telephone, with all its apparatus of mass communication, its satellites, its switches, its huge dishes and microwave technology, has clearly changed our world. But less obviously, the talking telegraph has apparently had its biggest impact on us at our most basic animal level. And it's created new kinds of scientists, phone anthropologists, who are having a field day.
55% of a person's impression of you is based on your appearance, so what you're wearing, all sorts of things about your appearance, and your body language, so the gestures, the facial expressions. So when you're talking on a telephone, you've eliminated 55%
of communication
is gone. Communication is gone. This is space-age technology for Stone-age brains. Definitely. I mean, our brains are stuck in the Stone Age. Our brains still think that we're hunter-gatherers living in tribal communities. And this is the kind of communication that we crave. We need that sort of...
So even though 55% of it isn't available on the telephone...
Hey, it's better to have some of it than none of it.
Yeah.
If you think about it, we always use the term keeping in touch, staying in contact. Mm. And that takes us even back further than the Stone Age, because that you're going back to the social grooming among chimps. You know, you're going back...
Picking
to
fleas out of one another. Yeah.
And that's effectively what we're doing. That's why we call it keeping in touch. It gives us that sense of contact.
So how come, and I don't think I'm alone, I don't like talking on any type of phone. I mean, my idea of the perfect conversation, you pick it up and you go, pub, and the person who's answering goes, yeah, and then you put the phone down.
You're like that because you're male. I think men need the visual connection. They need the body language signals as well. Also, men basically just don't like talking as much as women do. Probably gather from this conversation here, I seem to be doing an awful lot of talking.
Although I may be rendered semi-mute by the telephone, it seems that there are people out there, and some of them are men, who find its anonymity positively liberating. In New York, a Manhattan artist realized that people would say things on the phone that they wouldn't say face to face. During the 1980s, Mr. Apology, as he was called, invited members of the public to phone up and get things off their chest by leaving a message on an answer machine. And they did, in their thousands.
Hello, this is Mr. Apology speaking, and this tape is a sample of some of my favorite apologies.
To the 15 people that I've stolen money from, I'm sorry. In my life, I've taken all sorts of drugs.
All statements received by Apology will be played back to the public, so please do not identify yourself.
I steal from stores all the time. I really feel guilty.
Hi, I'm a police officer in Wisconsin. I just wanted to say I'm sorry to all those poor souls out there that wake up black and blue the next day after I beat the shit out of them.
Mr. Apology died in 1995, and now his widow looks after his bizarre legacy.
People that were talking sounded very sincere, really talking about things that were very painful and very personal. And I think the fact that they were talking to a telephone gave them a safety, a zone of safety, so that they could unburden themselves without fear of anyone really listening to them while they were talking.
So that I don't want to kill someone.
The tapes really encompass every aspect of humanity. Definitely a lot of confessions about crimes, petty crimes and serious crimes.
I embezzled $400,000 from a bank over a period of 6 years.
Religious issues.
I'm sorry I ever had sex for the first time, because now I too am a fallen woman and I should have never done that.
There's really nothing in the human condition that hasn't been discussed at great length on the apology line.
I killed Henry. He was a neighbor. He was a classmate of mine. It was partly his fault, because he shouldn't have kept teasing me about the size of my ears. And...
Obviously, the deeply troubled people who phoned Mr. Apology were protected by the anonymity offered by the fact that they couldn't be seen. Until the telephone, not being able to see someone who was talking to you was never an issue. But now, for the first time in human history, we are being forced routinely to make judgments about people we've never met or seen. We're basing all our opinions simply by talking to them.
I know, try an experiment. I've got six pictures here of people.
Yeah.
And they're waiting outside and they can talk to us on here.
Okay.
Let's see if you can match
the voices out there.
To the faces on there.
Okay, well, I should be able to tell the men from the women. Can I talk to number one?
Hello,
that's number one. Right, that discounts those three, the women. Tell me, where did you go on holiday this year?
I went to Bulgaria recently with the college exchange programme.
So he's an educated man. I'm going to go with that one is number one. Number two, can I talk to you?
Hello?
Hello, number two, yeah?
Yes, hello.
Hi, that's you, no problem. Thank you. Number three?
Hello.
Right, tell me, been in a fight recently?
No.
You've never been in a fight, that's you. Thank you, number three. Right, number four.
Hello.
Hi. Have you ever bought anything in Marks and Spencer's?
No.
Great. Right, so I've got, where have I got to? Number five. Number five, hello.
Hello.
That's you. And number six is going to be you. Let's just check it out, though. Hello, number six.
This is number five.
No, I know, I've finished with you now. You're a man, therefore I've... Yeah. Power of deductions caused me to work you out. Number six.
Hello.
Hello?
Hello.
Do you have children?
Yes, I have one.
What, how old?
She's like seven.
She's seven?
Yes.
Am I allowed to swap?
Yeah.
Sorry?
Okay, thanks very much. Thanks. Yeah. I'm going to do that and that.
Okay.
How did I do then?
You got them all right, every single one.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, there you go.
That's amazing.
Well, let's be honest, I am still the man.
I mean, would you have been able to tell whether any of those people liked you or not?
Of course they liked me.
Even though it's only been around for 100 years, the telephone and its culture is undergoing constant reinvention. 20 years ago, when we were beginning to think we'd got it sussed, the phone turned into something rather unexpected.
I've got my cellular radio phone here. That's it. You see, no cables attached at all, completely portable.
The mobile phone had arrived.
Hey, Michael, just before you go, come and have a look at this. Look at this, executive mobile phone. Tell you what, I'll show you how it works. I'll give you a little demonstration here. First of all, press that, and then you start. That's all right. I know what that is. I know, that's all right. The satellite has moved out of position, you see.
Today, 47 million people in the UK own a mobile phone. That's pretty much everyone who's capable of picking one up. It's a statistic that should cause us to hang our national head in shame for all that intrusion and irritation. But of course, I'm wrong. Again. Mobiles are actually a great social healer. Mobiles are engendering a new sense of community. Really?
What it's allowed us to do is to go back to an earlier, actually rather more humane pattern of communication, something that we'd lost. Mobile phone is like the garden fence. It's almost like you're carrying your social support network in your pocket. It's a lifeline, it's a connection to your social world.
So it's interesting, isn't it? We think of the mobile telephone as appealing to the sort of 21st century part of us, but actually what it's doing is appealing to the...
That's my mobile.
...really old part of us. That's a really horrible ring. Do you mind my saying that?
And that's the problem, isn't it? Ringtones. It's an object lesson in the danger of choice. If any unfortunate extraterrestrial picks up the sound of modern-day planet Earth, all he'll hear is the Nokia tune or the EastEnders theme played on a stylophone. But I'm whistling in the wind. The economy has spoken. Nowadays, pop groups make more from ringtones than singles. Kids spend more on mobiles than chocolate. People today feel bereft without their phones, and I suppose, if I'm honest, that it is incredible that someone can now reach me on the same number wherever I am in the world.
Hello? I'm actually in Beijing. Yeah, amazing. Yeah, that's Tiananmen Square. Do you hear it? It's the buzzer thing they sound. Hi, yeah, look, I'm in New Zealand. Ellie? No, I'm actually on a boat in the Mediterranean at the moment. I know, amazing reception. Bet it was like this in England, eh?
But there is a darker side to your friendly telecom fantasy enabler. Your mobile can turn on you. And I'm not talking about brain cancer or dodgy driving or memory loss. I'm talking about something that really ought to scare all of Britain's 47 million mobile users.
What most of these people don't realise is that as soon as you make a telephone call on your mobile, your location can be pinpointed to within 2 or 3 feet.
It's a commercially available service today. Provide the company with a mobile number and moments later, they'll tell you where that mobile is. Great if you're an anxious parent, not so great if you're an overprotected kid. There are some pretty serious civil liberties issues involved, but worse than that, the telephone has been used to track people down and kill them. That's what happened in Chechnya. The bloody battle for independence from Russia was in full swing. With his government building bombed to pieces, the self-declared Chechenian leader, General Dokhar Dudayev, took to the hills. Dudayev had lost count of the number of times the Russians had tried to kill him, but it's safe to say he didn't expect what happened next. In April of 1996, he stepped out of his car into a chilly spring evening. He had decided to try and negotiate a ceasefire with an intermediary in the Kremlin. But as soon as he turned on his satellite phone, Dudayev gave away his location. Immediately, the coordinates of Dudayev's position were sent to a Russian military plane, and the rest, for Dudayev at least, was history.
So, if you think I'm an irresponsible lout, you simply dial 0898 kill Clarkson, engage your satellite, fire your missile, and boof! Moments later, I'm a thin veneer all over those trees over there.
Ever since Bell's first phone call, the telephone's been used for flirting, lying, cheating, everything from little white lies to major brushes with the law. All activities that involved speaking.
150 years after its invention, the telephone took a giant leap backwards. Look at that. Look at it. What does it mean? It's like French. Hopper. It's just gibberish. I have never sent a text message, and I have no intention of doing so. But since about 112 million people do send them every day, it rather looks like this bizarre form of communication is here to stay. God help us.
Pioneers of the telephone may be turning in their graves, but Samuel Morse is probably feeling pretty pleased with himself, because this is little more than Morse code, and it's spreading like wildfire. In Britain today, we spend an incredible £1.7 billion a year on text messages, and a generation of children are actually growing up with bigger thumbs. Today you can arrange blind dates by text message, be dumped by text message, you can even get fired by text message.
What a way to learn you're fired. The text message that spells the end for accident group staff.
As far as texting's concerned, why is that caught on to the extent it has, do you think?
If you think about what I call the village green conversation, well, the kind of conversations we used to have when we lived in small communities. It's kind of, hi, how are you? Fine, just off to the shops. Oh, yeah, how's your mum, by the way? Is she better? Yeah, she's much better, thanks. Right, see you later. Basically, a connection has been made. If you take half the vowels out of that conversation, it's an absolutely typical text exchange. It's about keeping in touch. without necessarily having a great deal to say. I mean, you should really get into texting. Texting is right up your street. It's, you can avoid having a conversation.
No, but they're sitting there doing that, such a teenage thing to do.
Keep in touch with people who want you to keep in touch with them, who are going to get grumpy and antsy and bitchy if you don't keep in touch with them, right? But you don't actually have to talk to them. This is a male paradise, texting.
But my phone doesn't do texting.
Well, get one that does. How hard can it be?
Oh, it would mean phoning someone up.
Now, human communication is about to make another evolutionary leap, thanks to an idea that's been around for longer than you'd think.
At last it's happened, the thing we've been dreading for years, a TV telephone on show in San Francisco. Watch out, all you husbands who work overtime at the office. In the old days, it was just too easy to phone up the missus. But Mr. Smith of 1984 will have to think twice.
These video phones really revolutionised everything.
Because we now have everything. The verbal, the vocal, and the visual, body language.
Can you try flirting now?
So if I do a coy look, do you want to see if you can pick it up? So if
ooh, no, that's very flirty. Oh, yeah. Well, no, keep doing that, I quite like that. Well, you need to hold it higher for your best angle.
And you're just sitting there, don't you do anything?
No, I'm just looking gormless while you flirt.
Do something subtle, like sort of, you know. No, no, that's a female flirting gesture.
Well, give me a flirting gesture that I can do.
Smile? Okay, try intense eye contact. Let's do the copulatory gaze.
Actually, you look quite mad sometimes in that sort of
one. Yeah, I'd back off. See you. I'm trying to see you.
Yeah.
Oh, good. Very good. Yeah. Actually, this isn't the best angle for you either. Hold. What on earth is that supposed to be?
Me looking like Clint Eastwood.
The telephone really has come a long, long way since Elisha Gray's nephew wired himself up to the bath. Who'd have thought that Mr. Bell's historic call for Mr. Watson's assistance would have led to the mute banality of the text message, or that the telephone, a machine for speaking into, would eventually become equipped for seeing with too. But the device that enabled long-distance talking has one more surprise up its sleeve. This is a hologram of me. And even though it doesn't look much at present, it's apparently a glimpse of the future.
Pretty soon, you're going to be able to use your communicator to beam people to wherever you are. And not even Captain Kirk could do that. The phone has already changed the world. But imagine what this is going to do.
Thursday's invention that changed the world is the television. Well, it certainly changed my world. Without it, I wouldn't have a job. That's at the same time, 8 o'clock.